Tonight on 20 to 1, we're counting down 20 moments of madness.
He's exploiting this baby for entertainment purposes.
This is not a bloke who lives his life with his finger firmly planted on the control button.
I would have charged him.
Did you have a good time with those hookers last night?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
I mean, please, and come here. Smack, smack, smack.
He wouldn't be the first man that's been caught with his pants down, would he?
Good evening, and welcome to 20 to 1, Moments of Madness. I'm Bud Tingwell, and tonight we're counting down 20 of the worst decisions ever made by people in the public eye. So let's start at number 20 with the late great actor Oliver Reed and his infamous appearance on a British chat show.
Our guest is an actor who has kept audiences on the edge of their seats, directors on their toes, and dumped one or two awkward customers on their backs. Ladies and gentlemen, Oliver Reed.
Mate, listen. Which camera am I on?
All of them.
All the lights.
Everybody loves seeing someone drunk and disorderly on TV. It just breaks down all the conventions. And Oliver Reed probably did the best job of it that anyone's ever done.
I'd like to sing a song. Nobody knows this. It's a band, okay? And it was called I Was Known as the Wild One. And it goes roughly like this. I was known as the Wild One by all the folks around.
Of course, this was funny. The people laughed at Oliver in his cups, but it's also tragic because Oliver Reed was a very fine actor who unfortunately was in the grip of the grape and had been for a long time.
Thanks.
Well, thank you for coming. It's been a wonderful...
It was like a scene out of Pretty Woman. Only instead of a glamorous Julia Roberts lookalike, Hugh Grant picked up bargain basement floozy Divine Brown on Sunset Boulevard. Police, in turn, picked them up and charged them with lewd conduct.
Maybe onto some human level, he just needed to feel alive again. And God knows sleeping with a hooker does that for all of us.
The police say on Sunset Boulevard, he picked up a 23-year-old prostitute and drove her to a quiet street.
They observed the prostitute get into the vehicle. They then observed them drive a short distance to a nearby residential street and engage in an act of lewd conduct.
Well, he wouldn't be the first man that's been caught with his pants down, would he? It seems to me that men have a terrible lack of control. And I have no idea what he was thinking, except one thing, and obviously he didn't expect to get caught either.
Hugh hit the talk show circuit, apologising left, right and centre to anyone who would listen.
Has this happened to you before?
No.
Not that you were arrested before, that you'd done it like this before.
No.
Last night, I did something completely insane. I've hurt people I love and embarrassed people I work with. For both things, I'm more sorry than I can say.
In a way, as appalling as this story was, it gave him a bit of grunt, I think. Hugh Grant.
Ironically, the day of his arrest, he made this telling comment in an interview with 9 Months co-star Tom Arnold.
Closer, did you have a good time with those hookers last night?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Does Julie know about them?
Yes, she does. And you know, you're so smart for setting us up with them.
What?
You know, tell them about Friday night. We went to the Viper on Friday night. And who were you talking to?
I didn't talk to anyone. I wanted
yes,
to get home.
Yes, you did too. What was her name? She was from Turkey, that's all I know.
Wait a minute. Wasn't Divine from Turkey? Despite the very public apologies, the scandal placed a massive strain on his relationship with Liz Hurley, and the two separated shortly after.
Grant admitted he'd done a bad thing, but couldn't explain why.
But according to his grandmother...
Incredible. She just says, you know, what I tell people, darling, is that you had a few drinks with the boys and then got a bit fresh with the girls. I'll leave it at that.
At 18, some political mishaps. Let's face it, the economy is a pretty boring topic. So, when Treasurer Peter Costello appeared on Midday with Kerry Ann in 1996, nobody was surprised that all that boring talk about the budget would lead her to ask him to dance the Macarena.
It must be very difficult, but do you keep up with world trends?
Well, I try to.
They are that's the Macarena. Have you ever heard of the Macarena?
As of about 2 seconds ago, Kerry Ann.
Clearly, he's been told, Peter, you're too serious. We need to show your human side.
Is that right?
Would you like to dance?
Oh, Treasurer? I'd love to.
Would you like to dance? Okay. Now follow me, Treasurer.
Okay.
Just follow me. Right hand. Left hand. Hip. And now swim.
He didn't he look uncomfortable? I mean, it was excruciating television. Good on him for having a go. And clearly a lot of men have no rhythm, we know that.
He's a pretty smart bloke. I reckon in those moments when Kerry Ann was bunging it on him, I reckon he was rapidly processing it and thinking, is this good or is this bad? Is this good or is it? I think he decided, yeah, it could be good, could be okay.
And if you thought that was embarrassing, how about Alexander Downer? And those fishnet stockings.
You just cannot believe that anyone, any politician, would put on sequin shoes, stilettos, and fishnets and really think he's going to be taken seriously ever again.
Back in 1998, Pauline Hanson wanted to be taken seriously.
If you are seeing me now, it means I have been murdered.
Hello? What's this about? I mean, good heavens, what next? I don't know what Pauline Hanson was thinking when she did that and who was going to bump her off. That's what I could never work out.
If you are seeing me now, it means I have been murdered.
Yeah, that was a beauty. Yeah, if you're watching this video, I'm dead. You know, messages from the grave.
I know that Pauline's probably watching this now and she's thinking, what was I thinking?
Well, it was an amazing time, the Pauline Hanson phenomenon that hit, and Tracy Curro's 60 Minutes interview with her where she was asked if she was xenophobic.
Are you xenophobic? Please explain.
Xenophobia means a fear of all things foreign.
No, I don't think I am.
You know, please explain is now part of the common vernacular in Australia because of this cultural phenomenon that was Pauline Hanson. It's just
like the fellas. I hear she's a good ballroom dancer these
tell
days.
Me quick, ain't that a kick in the air? Hey!
And in 1992, the Queen's visit to Australia was livened up immensely when Paul Keating got overly familiar with Lizzie, I mean Her Majesty, as he was introducing her to members of Parliament. He was probably trying to stop her from leaping backwards in horror.
Do you know, I don't think that a single Australian journo covering that tour would have seen anything in it. It was the British press that made a big deal of it. And then, of course, we picked it up, obviously, because the British press said, no one touches her. No one touches Mum.
At number 17... Sure, you've seen them before, but back again by popular demand, it's Ron Casey and Normie Rowe.
It was a midday show with Ray Martin. It was a political forum and being debated this day, republicanism.
Right, then, what
do you know
it?
What that is?
What is it? What is it?
I mean, the thing I liked about this when they went the biff is that Australians will fight over anything with the word pub in it.
Excuse me, he's not going to push me.
Hang on, let's just take a break.
Push me and see how you get off. Push me again.
Hang on. It's a shame that they cut the fight short because I know the winner was going on to meet Jeannie Little in the final, and I think that's what's great about political debate. That's how Australians like to do it with a bit of biff.
What is it?
I always thought perhaps there was a bit of show business involved in the whole event myself.
Hang on.
Stop it!
Hang on.
Stop it! He's not going to push me.
Everyone was shocked on principle. So they ran it over and over again. Listen, we're really shocked. We'll play it again for you now, and we're really sorry. Oh, isn't that shocking? We'll play it again a little later in the program. I mean, oh, come on.
Ron and Normie were reunited for a Bushels tea ad in 2000, the concept being enemies uniting over a cup of tea. Just don't give Normie any coffee.
There you are, Normie.
Thanks, mate.
That's it, boys. Play nicely from now on. Welcome back to 20-1 Moments of Madness, the ultimate countdown of some of the most dubious decisions ever made. At 16, people have been telling rugby league players to pull their finger out for years. And in the case of former West's Tiger, John Hopewate, well, they got that right.
Winger John Hopewate has been found guilty of conduct unbecoming to the game. Now, there's no delicate way of putting this. He was charged with poking his fingers into the backsides of opposing players.
When the whole Hopewate thing broke, people were just staggered, absolutely staggered. And it made headlines around the world, each one uglier than the last.
John Hopewate described his on-field actions as a tactic that he used to upset the opposition. And in fact, this disturbing tactic had gone on for weeks before Hopewate was finally exposed.
Hopewate, he's sticking his finger up people's asses, mate. Like, he's done it twice.
Okay, I'll have a look at it. I'll have a look, mate.
I've seen a lot of things in sport, and a lot of things that later on you can laugh about, but I felt I couldn't laugh about that. I think that's probably the most unsavoury thing I've seen in sport. You can go for head-high tackles and you know, spear tackles and fights that break out and whatever else. But that, I thought, was just awful.
You got pretty thick, stupid people basically playing football, and you ask them to be model citizens, and they end up going wrecking things. No, they are absolute numbskulls.
On the other hand, other Aussie football codes were quick to see the humour in it and poked fun at Hopewate.
Coon or Kraft, putting the holes in the cheese head, and then the donuts, the old standard Ted. Now, that was a winner, that.
But the best line of all was a guy called Paul Holmes in New Zealand who does their version of A Current Affair. And he said, and coming up after the break, we have John Hopewate. Is he a monster? Is he an animal? Or is he just lonely?
And coming in at number 15, George Michael comes out of the closet, the water closet.
Mr. Michaels was arrested for a violation, engaging in a lewd act.
It's a bit of an LA landmark, of course, these days, that famous park opposite the Beverly Hills Hotel on Sunset Boulevard where Georgie Michael went and got himself into a lot of trouble.
I've actually been to that toilet. So my husband and I went along, and I've got a photo of my husband coming out of the toilet with his pants half up, sort of blocking the paparazzi like this.
The fact that he had to hang out at the toilets is actually a little bit sad, you know. I mean, he's very wealthy. He could have built his own toilet block somewhere and pretended that it was a public one.
George Michael parodied his arrest in the video clip for Outside.
He was a cry for help, cry for attention. He was yearning to be free of the shackles of teeny bopper love and little girls, you know, loving him and having posters on their wall.
He was caught, pants down.
George was ultimately fined $800 and sentenced to perform community service.
Officers observed the act and arrested Mr. Michaels.
The incident in Los Angeles forced George, I suppose, to come out of the closet and say, hey, I'm gay. There you go, an interesting episode for our Georgie boy.
Tonya Harding is hoping to stave off a bid to kick her out of the Winter Olympics, and for the first time today she spoke out about the attack on Nancy Kerrigan and her ex-husband's claim that she was involved.
I had no prior knowledge of the planned assault on Nancy Kerrigan.
It was the hit heard around the world.
For a lot of people now, it's made it very difficult to watch any sort of figure skating without thinking immediately of The Sopranos.
Jealous figure skater Tonya Harding conspired to attack American national champion and Olympic gold medalist Nancy Kerrigan 1 month before the 1994 Winter Olympics.
You know, I may have some bad points about me, but overall I think I'm a pretty good person.
This chick's come along and thought,
what's standing between me and probably a podium finish is this chick. So she's got the old man to, you know, launch the attack with the baseball bat.
Are you guilty of the allegations as stated by your attorney?
I am.
There was no escaping the reality. Tonya's ex-husband pleaded guilty in the plot to attack rival Nancy Kerrigan.
It was just one of the most bizarre stories. It sort of had a ring of untruth about it. It was so bizarre.
Nobody could believe a figure skater could be part of such an evil scheme. Least of all, her own mother.
She would never do that, not to a competitor. She wouldn't even hurt a fly if she could help it.
Unless, of course, the fly was a better figure skater than she was. Then she'd put the smack down on it for sure. Within 2 months of the attack, Tonya Harding admitted her guilt and received a suspended sentence.
But she's now doing boxing, I think, isn't she? Perfect.
Ice skating bad girl Tonya Harding squared up to Paula Jones, famous for her allegations of sexual harassment against former President Bill Clinton.
Well, at least it's a better way of channeling her anger. Boozy benders, marijuana smoking, and punch-ups with paparazzi. At 13, it's just another day in the life of Prince Harry.
Prince Harry is again in the headlines for all the wrong reasons after he was pictured wearing a swastika armband at a fancy dress party.
Prince Harry, I mean, what a twit. What an absolute twerp. And, you know, I mean, no connection to reality, no connection to real life. Hey, here's a funny idea. I'll wear a Nazi armband and I'll go to a fancy dress party. I mean, please, and come here, smack, smack, smack.
This is really like a Windsor being in a real knot, isn't it? I mean, it's the Windsor knot.
It was a bad taste party. And, you know, there's nothing more bad taste than a member of the royal family dressed as a Nazi. But he's my favourite. He drinks, he smokes. What a great gig.
For someone in his position, to wear a uniform like that was stupid and offensive and juvenile. And I don't know how his mind has allowed him to, but then clearly he gave him the slip for the night.
I am very sorry, he said, if I've caused any offence. It was a poor choice of costume and I apologise.
Welcome back to 20 to 1, Moments of Madness. It's time to recap what we've seen so far and give those latecomers the chance to play catch-up.
At 20, Oliver Reed's dancing leaves a lot to be desired. At 19, it was Hugh Grant's moment of divine madness. At 18, some politicians made an exhibition of themselves. At 17, Normie Rowe and Ron Casey had a blue. At 16, it's the classic, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Finger. At 15, George Michael comes out of the water closet. At 14, Tonya Harding starts a new Olympic sport, disc figure skating. And at 13, Prince Harry makes our worst dressed list. And coming in at number 12, it's Father of the Year, Michael Jackson.
After first greeting his fans from a four-floor window, he returned holding onto a baby with its face covered. The child is thought to be Jackson's youngest, Prince Michael II. Left dangling 20 metres up, he's clearly uncomfortable as he kicks out his legs.
My stomach turned when I saw that. This tiny little baby with a blanket over its face being dangled over a balcony. I had a visceral response to it, just this is disgusting.
In a statement, the singer said he was caught up in the excitement of the moment.
It's playing up a media moment, but indirectly putting a child at risk. I wouldn't dangle my child outside the window of a multi-level hotel.
Jackson wasn't finished, reverting to his reclusive self as he threw what appeared to be the blanket that covered the baby's head.
It is really sad that the guy has custody of those two kids. Can't imagine what they're going to turn out like.
But later, as if to show that all was normal again, Jackson and the children reappeared on his balcony with heads uncovered.
I think it was probably the worst example of a take your child to work day I have ever seen.
At 11, we've seen many winners and losers on Australia's own Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Molly Meldrum was one of our best celebrity winners.
But his response was one of the great nights on Australian television. It was a wonderful thing to be a part of, to be sitting as far away as we are here, just watching him go through the full range of emotions. I mean, he went from being petrified to being excited to second-guessing himself to all sorts of things, and finally got through and won the $500,000.
He's a goat for five!
And then there was the much-loved, often loathed, and always controversial Red Simons.
All right. Very sad the way Australia treats its heroes, isn't it?
Get this wrong, you lose $15,000 and you have to...
All right.
You've got two lifelines, 50-50, phone a friend.
I'll go with Mexico City, hey.
Lock it in? Lock in Mexico City. And Mexico City was in 1968. You've won $32,000.
When Millionaire's going, the lights and the music changes the atmosphere. But once you get up to the big money, you can hear the silence in the studio.
Oh, you're doing the lights now, aren't you?
Yeah, now we're getting right into
creepy lights and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it's a different type of silence. It's people aren't breathing. There's no shuffling in the seats. There's no cracking of knuckles or anything like that. People are absolutely rigid, and you can basically hear the silence.
Hey, Britain.
Sure.
Oh, stop that, Eddie.
All right.
You're such a kibitzer, aren't you?
Don't want a lifeline?
No.
You wouldn't want to get it wrong, would you?
I've got 32 grand. Who cares? Dump my money.
As well as he played, eventually Red's confidence and cavalier attitude led to his very own moment of madness.
Believe me, in the moment, you are struggling to retain a sense of where you are and what you're doing and how much is riding on what you say.
C music, D sculpture.
B architecture.
Lock it in. No lifeline. Lock it in. Locked in architecture. Red, you've just lost $218,000. It was sculpture.
Oh dear.
But Red's face was just priceless. And as I said, as far as television was concerned, it was absolutely fantastic.
And giving us a fright at number 10, don't look now, but it's The Bride of Wildenstein.
Now, didn't she have this extreme jungle cat makeover because her husband was obsessed with jungle cats?
Oh, meow!
When you see this woman, you actually have to say which way is up.
The ironic thing about Jocelyn Wildenstein is that you look at the before and after pictures and she looks so much better in the before. She was a really attractive woman.
Look, it's hard to imagine what the appeal is. You go on a date with a woman like that, she jumps on the roof of your car and licks her feet for an hour.
Meow!
Isn't beauty from within? You know, is it skin deep? Clearly, she hasn't got that message. It's really sad.
There are not many celebrities whose surgery make Michael Jackson look almost normal, but Jocelyn Wildenstein is one of them. Welcome back to 20 to 1, where we're counting down our top 20 moments of madness. Dermot Heidenreich's performance as the laconic, lovable Pizza Hut delivery boy endeared him to the nation and made Dougie the Pizza Boy a household name.
He was getting a whole lot of fame for being the pizza boy. The women loved him, he was a good-looking bloke, a little twinkle in his eye when he delivered your pizza.
Two large pizzas are now only $15.90, so normally you save a dollar. But tonight, you don't. See ya.
I wonder what happened to poor Dougie. I know he had his travails with substances you don't normally get in a chemist store.
Dougie was happily rolling in Pizza Hut dough. And then there was that fateful night when he got behind the wheel of his girlfriend's four-wheel drive. Foolishly, our fast-living delivery boy was fueled on the night by a dangerous cocktail of drugs and alcohol. And he crashed into a tree, injuring both his girlfriend and his lucrative Pizza Hut contract.
Goodbye.
And then he messed up, driving a car and got convicted of something and ended up having to do weekend detention. And if he wasn't there in 30 minutes, he got off free.
shaking it at number 8, the politician so popular he deserves his own number. It's Bob Hawke and his blushing bride, Blanche Delpuget.
You want more in the front?
It's certainly no longer a secret love. Clearly, Bob and Blanche can't get enough of one another.
Do you know, if I'd been that 60 Minutes journo, I would have been counting my blessings, thinking, I can't believe they said yes. I can't believe we asked them if they'd do the stuff in the white bathrobe, and they went yes.
I think on some level we all were sort of sitting back going, it's just a little bit too much, really.
And I mean, there they were, two highly charged sexual beings who discovered the joys of fake tan and terry toweling and all those wonderful things you can do with those two elements.
The oiling up, and I mean, it was, you're just sort of going, oh. You know, it elicits that great Australian response, which is, get a room.
My feet are much nicer than his.
Oh.
Yes, you do have pretty feet.
He caricatured himself almost, and I don't know what he was thinking in those moments. I think he was just in love. He just decided he was going to do and be whatever he wanted, and what he wanted at that time was to wear white bathrobes and profess his love for Blanche. Fine.
At number 7, President Ronald Reagan was always on top of things. He was also known as the great communicator.
The system is still where it was with regard to progressivity, as I've said.
Television viewers were reminded how he dozed off during a meeting with the Pope and how wife Nancy had to help him out in answering a reporter's question.
Anything you can do to get them to the
end? Doing everything we can.
But, on the other hand, Ronald Reagan did have his clever moments.
I am not going to exploit, for political purposes, my opponent's youth and inexperience.
I think he had a sense of humour. Sometimes, you know, people laughed at him whether he meant them to or not, but...
But years of growing animosity between the US and the Soviet Union reached massive levels of tension during the first term of Ronald Reagan. He called the Soviet Union an evil empire and developed the Star Wars defense system in 1983 to combat it.
My fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We begin bombing in 5 minutes.
First rule of anything to do with broadcasting, never say anything when you're around a microphone that you're not happy for your mother to hear.
And so when they shoot themselves in the foot, you just say, thank you. Beauty.
Probably will bag Reagan for this, but I suppose one thing he worked to say in his favour, as opposed to the current president, is he probably could find Russia on a map.
I just thought when I came into office it was time that there was some realistic talk to and about the Soviet Union. And we did get their attention.
We begin bombing in 5 minutes.
Welcome back to 20 to 1, Moments of Madness.
At number 6, meet Alan Williams, a man who had an expensive moment of madness when he gave away the Beatles.
I'll tell you about envy. I must be the most envious man in the whole world, having let millions slip through my fingers.
He made a decision which has haunted him ever since. He handed them over for nothing to a furniture salesman called Brian Epstein with a warning that the Beatles would never make the big time and were bound to let him down. He's now had 20 years to envy the success he's failed to achieve himself. Alan Williams is the man who gave the Beatles away. Must be hell. Why did you give the Beatles up in the first place?
Well, it was a row over commission. I had a row with John Lennon. He didn't want to pay my 10%. And so I said, right, I'll fix it, Lennon, that you'll never ever work again. And it was me who never worked again.
Yeah. How would you feel? The greatest rock and roll band of all time. And this guy's had to basically endure the rest of his life as the, you know, the guy who said, I'd never sign them, they're rubbish.
Over the last 20 years, I suppose you've had a moments when you must have really felt unbelievably envious. What's it done to you to know that you lost all those millions of pounds?
I drink too much. It's driven me to drink.
But you do have to wonder what would have happened if he'd stuck with them, because his obvious lack of talent as a manager, they'd be playing shopping centres and RSLs, and it's a tragedy all around, isn't it?
Please welcome Britney Spears.
At number five, Britney Spears makes a very costly visit to Australia.
There's nothing you can do or say.
In 2001, Britney Spears signed a multi-year marketing deal with Pepsi, reportedly worth $7 million. Later that year, she toured Australia.
We got a photo sent to us from, you know, a paparazzi guy here. She was holding a Coke bottle.
And how fit can you be? You're on a media tour. Someone's paying you $1 million to drink their drink. Just pick up the right can. Not that I endorse soft drink, but anyway.
I mean, surely you could just find an old can of Pepsi and pour the Coke into it if you're that desperate to drink the other product.
It was literally the week before they had announced in the States that she had signed a multi-million dollar deal. And it was a huge story. It was, you know, a monumental act of stupidity again.
And it's easy to lose your fizz in the soft drink business. Britney Spears has been canned as the face of Pepsi, replaced by the singer and actress Beyoncé Knowles.
And at number four, we asked the question, what's the difference between Skippy and Wayne Carey? Well, Skippy can sleep with whomever he likes and still be a kangaroo.
He was the AFL's first million-dollar man. Wayne Carey was the Kangaroos. He loomed over the entire game like no other.
The King kicks three goals in 7 minutes.
Last night, the 13-year career of one of the greatest AFL players unravelled in a 37-second statement.
I've taken the decision to cease my playing career with the Kangaroos. I regret the circumstances of my actions, which has led to the decision, and the pain it has caused to my wife and my family.
Kangaroos captain Wayne Carey became a marked man when his teammates refused to play alongside him. All this after an affair with his vice-captain's wife was revealed.
There is all sorts of cultural codes for the way we Australians operate. And the first rule of the Australian male cultural code is you don't stoop your best mate's missus.
Carey's actions embarrassed his family, the club, and of course gave the AFL footy show plenty of material.
I regret the circumstances of my actions, which have led to the decision to remain with the footy show.
But he was the biggest name in footy. He was the king. And, you know, when the king falls from grace, there's plenty of people lining up to have a go.
Carey played out the last two seasons of his career with the Adelaide Crows, but he got to see his old teammates again when the Crows played the Kangaroos sometime later.
Welcome back to 20 to 1, where we've reached tonight's top three moments of madness. Arriving at number three, it's Winona Ryder's five-finger discount.
It's CCTV footage from inside the store last December when the Oscar-nominated star was accused of shoplifting over £3,000 worth of clothes.
Don't they pay you enough money, Winona? Aren't they paying her enough money in movies that she's got to go and steal stuff? I mean, my God.
Winona had twice been nominated for Academy Awards when she made the decision to shoplift $10,000 worth of high fashion merchandise from boutique clothes shop Saks Fifth Avenue.
Boy, you wonder what makes some people do what they do, and I'm sure Winona Ryder would. What was her excuse? That she was on, she was doing research for a film or something, wondering what it would be like.
And the Oscar goes to. This is really taking method acting to new extremes. I just think that it was a cry for help. I don't think that Winona needs a handbag. I think she needs a hug. I don't think she needs a coat. I think she needs a cuddle.
A cuddle? Here's Winona busted after her own moment of madness.
Because she supported.
She claimed she wasn't guilty, but this didn't stand up in court, even though Winona did. She was sentenced to an $18,000 fine, 500 hours of community service, and an Adam Sandler movie.
Yeah, she's guilty.
They say you should never work with children or animals, or Steve Irwin, especially if you're Baby Bob, or Lunch, as he's known around the crocodile pen.
Steve Irwin is no longer Australia's favourite crocodile hunter. In fact, the knives are out right across the world.
Tonight, we talk live to Steve Irwin from our Brisbane studio. A distressed crocodile hunter has been in seclusion for the past 2 days since these pictures were beamed around the world.
This is not a bloke who lives his life with his finger firmly planted on the control button. And I certainly think that with Baby Bob, I do think he was ill-advised. And I think that every question I asked him in that interview represented that point of view.
And you know what, mate? I'm proud of what I do, and the thing that has hurt me the most is that people would perceive what I do as dangerous. Have a look at this, Tracy. This is my mum. This is 1996, Mother's Day. We caught 12 crocodiles that day. That's not very normal.
I'm sure that Steve would look at that moment today and wish he had made a different decision.
Right here, Tracy, is a tape from the Australia Zoo camera, which will give you another angle, so all of that ugly stacked up vision of me with the croc looking like I'm endangering my child will be put to bed very quickly. My dad did the same for me.
And Steve did the same with his firstborn, daughter Bindi.
She's the most well-rounded, croc-savvy kid in the world, and it's because I took her in with the crocs when she was 1 month of age.
But I think that moment was also a wake-up call for Steve in regards to the level of fame that he had around the world.
Look at this. He's exploiting this baby near a deadly animal for entertainment purposes. I mean, I would have charged him.
This is a bloke who can be a loose cannon. And I think that's been part of his appeal because he doesn't look polished all of the time. He does the whole, I'm Steve Irwin, and if you don't like it, well, plenty of other people do.
If I had my time again, perhaps I'd do things differently.
Well, we've made it all the way to number one.
At number one, it's the now infamous underarm incident.
The biggest sports story of the year was also the most controversial. The Melbourne Cricket Ground, the 1st of February, and Australia are playing New Zealand in the final series of the one-day championship.
Long discussion. Well, it looks to me as if they're going to bowl underarm off the last ball. Rod Marsh is saying no, mate, but I'm sure he's going to bowl an underarm delivery.
Well, I remember at the time watching it because I was shortlisting doing a news story, and I'm thinking to myself, what is going on? You saw the conversation going on between the two Chappell brothers. You saw the confusion between the two Kiwi batsmen.
The umpires have been told, the batsmen have been told, and this is possibly a little bit disappointing.
I mean, the most intense sporting rivalry of all is between the local derby, Australia versus New Zealand. We were the big brother, and there was the real big brother, Greg Chappell, telling his little brother, Trevor, to do those New Zealanders over, and they did.
They're going to bowl an underarm. You haven't believed it. And that's a disappointing finish. Disappointed Brian McKechnie, the crowd boo. And it's all over.
At the time, I watched a lot of cricket on the television, and I do remember that last ball, and I remember being just a little bit confused as to exactly what was happening.
You haven't believed it.
But I was only 10 years old. What do I know about that sort of stuff?
The reaction at the time, I mean, when it happened, and when you thought, gee, the Kiwis are going to go right off. And of course they did.
I described Greg Chappell's actions as an act of cowardice, and I thought it was most appropriate that the Australian team was dressed in yellow.
A lot of people, and perhaps myself included, are of the opinion that if you can't win playing, I guess, you know, the Aussie way, then there's no point winning.
It was done. It was not good, but gee, you know, it was get over it. I couldn't believe that it lasted so long. That somehow or other, we're still talking about it 25 years on, because I tell you what the real reason is, because those bloody New Zealanders won't get over it, all right?
Thank you for watching tonight's show, and indeed the series. I hope you've enjoyed yourself as much as I have. Goodbye.
We begin bombing in 5 minutes.